Today we are going to read this book, Ignited Minds by APJ Abdul Kalam, Unleashing the Power Within India. Okay, so we'll start with acknowledgement. I have listed some of the books that were useful to me in the writing of this book. I would like to mention three books whose ideas I found specially relevant to my theme. Chandrasekhar by Kameshwar C. Wali, Penguin Books, Empire of the Mind by Dennis Waitley, Nicholas Bialy Publishing, and Manifest Your Destiny by Dr. Wayne W. Dyer, HarperCollins. Some of Dr. Dyer's ideas on individual achievement I found useful in addressing the theme of nation's awakening to its potential. The other books that I consulted are listed in the reference. Preface. Nations consist of people, and with their effort a nation can accomplish all it could ever want. Motivating people, India's people and its youth especially, is the central theme of Ignited Minds, which continues the trajectory of thoughts taken up in my earlier two books, Wings of Fire and India 2020, A Vision for the New Millennium, written with my friend Arun Tiwari and Y.S. Rajan. I have chosen to write about this subject of igniting young minds so that India turns into a developed nation by the year 2020, because all through my career in the field of technology and its management, I rely on the power and potential of youth. My strength has been my young teams who never let me down, and what satisfaction there was in working with them on some of the most complex projects in some of the most challenging situations. Given the freedom to achieve and guide it properly, I am convinced the young of India can accomplish far more. As I began writing, I wondered if I was not overreaching myself. I thought, who am I to write about this capacity of India to realize its destiny as a developed nation? What do I really know about how this can be accomplished beyond what I have learned in my projects and missions evolved around science and technology? Isn't this an area that political leaders, economists, thinkers, and other competent people would address better? How am I qualified to tell others about an ability that has been generally ignored? At first, as I was putting down my experiences with youth, I had no idea of what I would have to say. However, I put aside my doubts and began to examine what I hear from the people I meet during my visits to different places, particularly children, saints and seers, teachers, scientists, industry leaders, and even political leaders. I am sure on my part that India has the ability to transform itself into a developed nation. Through my projects in space, defense, and nuclear sector, I know that our people have the ability to achieve the best in the world. They have a fantastic mix of belief and knowledge that sets them apart from any other nation on earth. I also know that their potential has gone untapped because we have become used to being subjugated and docile. What better project can I undertake than to tell my people that what they dream of can become possible, and they can have anything that comprises a good life, health, education, the freedom to pursue their goals, and above all, peace. My quest for answers as to how this could be done took me to schools, the countryside, ashrams, and many other places which were not part of my itinerary earlier. It was a new kind of experience, a very stimulating one at that. The paddy fields in Bihar left to an ad hoc cycle of agriculture, the untapped mineral wealth of newly formed state of Jharkhand, and the unattended biodiversity of Tripura are throwing a great challenge to the knowledge era that is dawning. In Assam, the sight of the mighty Brahmaputra almost mesmerized me. Its vast expanse of water filled me with a strange sense of helplessness too. The river's untapped flow was taking a gigantic mass of water into the sea. It made me think that as a nation too, we were failing to utilize our tremendous energies. Where are we making a mistake? What is that needs to be corrected? We have a roadmap in our 5-year plans that covers some of the things we need to achieve. We have most of the necessary resources. There seems to be an attitude problem, as if we cannot shake ourselves out of the mindset of limited achievements. This book is all about breaking away from the forces that would prefer us to remain a nation of a billion people selling cheap labor and raw materials and providing a large market for goods and services of other nations. I am writing this book to make my young readers hear a voice that says, start moving. Leadership must lead us to prosperity. Young Indians with constructive ideas should not have to see them wither in the long wait for approval. They have to rise above norms which are meant to keep them timid in the name of safety and to discourage entrepreneurship in the name of trade regimes, organizational orders and group behavior. As it is said, thinking is the capital, enterprise is the way, hard work is the solution. Every nation has struggled to achieve its goal. Generations have given their best to make life better for their offspring. There is nothing mysterious or hidden about this. No alternative to effort, and yet we fail to follow the winning track. More than the problems outside, globalization, recession, inflation, insurgencies, instability, and so on, I am concerned about the inertia that has gripped the national psyche, the mindset of defeat. I believe that when we believe in our goals, that what we dream of can become reality, result will begin to follow. I ignited minds is about developing that conviction in ourselves and discarding the things that hold us back. This was, in fact, a central thought that I kept in mind as I wrote. Share my dream of a developed India and see it made real in your own and others' lives. In my own way, I have tried to follow my beliefs, to do what I love doing. I have tried, however, to guide but not to impose my views on others. You will find in this book, plain speaking, surge ahead as a developed nation or perish in perpetual poverty, subservient to a few countries that control the world politically and economically. There are no other alternatives. In the 9th chapter of this book, I take my various themes. I begin with a rumination on peace, without which there can be no progress, on the shift in the direction of my own life that occurred after surviving a helicopter crash. There is a chapter based on my interaction with children all over India. Other chapters contain the insights I gained in my meetings with saints and seers, scientists, outstanding thinkers and others. There are accounts of some promising experiments in agriculture and in field. Elsewhere, I deal with concepts that carry the seed of solution. The contents essentially come from the people of this nation, from what they have taught me. I have written this book as an expression of my faith in the potential of India and my countrymen. We have all the resources we need, whether it be people, talent, natural bounty, or other assets. India is truly blessed with a real, though latent, abundance. Scarcity of resources is not the cause of our problems. Our problems originate in our approach towards them. We are spreading our resources too wide and too thin. With our resources and the money we spend, we could easily accomplish 3 times what we do in half the time we normally take. And if we were to operate in mission mode with a vision for the nation, the vision generates the best in every field. We must change track. It's imperative that our policy making becomes more responsive and efficient so that the stifled entrepreneurship is liberated. Key to that is better coordination among the various departments rather than emphasis on priorities according to the preferences of individual departments. There are more reviews than views available. Every channel appears blocked by some obstacle or the other. The trapped energies and the suppressed initiatives need to be freed and properly harnessed. Nor do we particularly need every time to borrow models from elsewhere. I don't think the Americans, Japanese or Singaporean solution will work for us. Knocking at others' doors will be futile. Instead of importing theories and transplanting concepts, we need to grow our own solutions. Instead of searching for answers outside, we will have to look within for them. I hope that when we go through these 9 chapters, you will be given the guidance that I got from the people of my country and feel connected to the wisdom that is so special to the soil. The reality of a developed nation will become part of your daily life. 20 years from now, I may not be around, but I'm sure many of you will be there to share in the glory of success and agree that I'm right in being so confident. Many friends and associates helped me to put this book together. I'm grateful to them all. My special thanks to Mr. Y.S. Rajan and M.S. Vijay Raghavan for shaping my thoughts with their vital inputs, and Mr. Dr. A. Shivanathu Pillai has worked with me for a long time and his contribution has been both timely and invaluable in giving shape to ideas and thoughts. I am fortunate to have his friendship. I am grateful to Mr. H. Shiridon who directly keyed in my dictation into his laptop computer with outstanding skill. My co-author in Wings of Fire, Mr. Arun K. Tiwari, did his usual craftsmanship with words on the manuscript, and I appreciate every bit of that. It was a great pleasure to work with Mr. Krishna Chopra of Penguin Books. From the emanation of my thoughts to the books, realization, his constant interaction was of great support. Chennai, April 2002, APJ Abdul Kalam. So now we go to the chapter 1, the dream and the message. Dream. Dreams transform into thoughts and thoughts result in action. On 30th September 2001, I was on my way to Bokaro from Ranchi in Jharkhand when the helicopter carrying me crashed moments before landing. It hit the earth with a thud after its engine failed. All of us on board had a miraculous escape. Grateful to God but unfazed by the incident, I went ahead with my scheduled program of addressing the students in Bokaro. At night, however, a panel of doctors persuaded me to take a tranquilizer to alleviate my perceived shock. The drug made me sleep hours ahead of my usual time, 1 a.m. and I also failed to raise at my usual 6 a.m. and woke up only after 8 o'clock. It was, however, a disturbed sleep, and sometime in the middle of it I fell to thinking why the human race, the best of all of God's creation, has been so deeply divided by violence. I imagined a conversation between 5 people who together symbolize the finest attributes of the human mind and whom I admire deeply. Through their conversation, I sought an answer. In this experience, much more intense and vivid than a dream, though for want of a better word, I shall term it that, I saw myself in a desert with miles of sand all around. There was a full moon and the desert was bathed in its light. 5 men, Mahatma Gandhi, Albert Einstein, Emperor Ashoka, Abraham Lincoln and Caliph Omar, stood in a circle and their clothes ruffled by the wind. I felt myself dwarfed standing next to the majestic Emperor Ashoka. Ashoka led 2 lives, one as a ruthless conqueror and the other as a compassionate ruler. The man I stood beside was the one who had just returned from conquest, but victory had been obtained at heavy cost. The Battle of Kalinga claimed the lives of at least 300,000 people and an equal number were wounded. I saw everyone looking at Ashoka, who fell on his knees and removed his armor and crown. His face was pale, reflecting the death surrounding him. He looked at the sky. He saw the bright, cool moon shining and the God's grace pouring down on Mother Earth. And he looked down at the horror he had created, making blood flow everywhere. In that moment of beauty and horror, the silver moonlight and the suffering and the pain on the ground, and nature itself seemed to speak out against what he had wrought, Ahimsa Dharma was born. Emperor Ashoka embraced God's commands to propagate love for human beings through his doctrine. As I stood by, I wondered why the Kalinga War, why the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi and of Abraham Lincoln or many others like them, and God Almighty flattered in his creation. faltered in his creation? Is the destruction of mankind essential for a second creation? In that blissful silence, the Mahatma spoke. Friends, the divine message we are hearing is the message of creation. Since we all belong to planet Earth, we may give a message to mankind how people of different race, religions and languages can live peacefully and prosperously together. God Almighty has blessed us all with something unique that we passed on to mankind through our deeds and efforts. Is that working? Is there any divine message or doctrine? Divine beauty should enter the human soul and happiness blossom in the body and mind. Is it possible? Ashoka said, friends, there is one thing I have realized. There is no victory in causing suffering. Triumph is a peaceful kingdom. Caliph Omar said, I learned after I entered Jerusalem that all men are equal. There is no point forcing others to follow your path. You will get only that which is ordained for you. God alone is the sovereign. Caliph Omar never saw his position in terms of the special privileges that it carried. To him, government was a sacred trust, and he did his best not to betray that trust in any way. It was Einstein's turn. I would like to recall my friend Werner Heisenberg's view. You know, in the West, we built a large, beautiful ship. It has all the comforts in it, but one thing is missing. It has no compass and does not know where to go. Men like Tagore and Gandhi and their spiritual forebears found the compass. Why can this compass not be put in the human ship so that both can realize their purpose? Abraham Lincoln, the great American leader who fought against slavery and whose life paralleled that of the Mahatma in certain respects, said at that point, there is one thing that I would like to say. Happiness comes from a family's prosperity at various levels. God's grace gives bliss to human lives. Happiness and bliss are two important components of a godly life on earth. Perhaps there is so much conflict between people and nation because in our pursuit of prosperity and power, we have lost sight of ethical values. We must ask ourselves, what is the role of human consciousness? Does it have a part in political thinking, scientific thinking, and theological thinking? Is spirituality acceptable in the business of life? Mahatma Gandhi recalled sage Ashtavakra, who propounded, "Oh my son, you are the very consciousness within which arises this phenomenal universe that is not separate from what you are. How can there be a question of anything being acceptable or not acceptable? Let the business of life be peace and prosperity and not exploitation and conflict. This is our message to the planet. Everything that we do, any doctrine that we espouse, should be for the good of humankind." The next morning, I kept sitting for some time, drinking my tea and pondering about this strange dream. What if the helicopter had lost power at some more height? Just a few hours before my own mishap, a plane carrying a promising leader and a team of young and talented journalists had crashed, killing all. I had been lucky to survive, and now there was the night's experience that seemed to hold a message for me. What should I do? I looked out of the window. The sun was well up in the sky and there was a soothing breeze. I've always lived in close touch with nature and always found it a friend, giving without reservation, like the mango tree. People throw stones at it, break off its branches, but it still offers its shade to the weary traveler and its fruits to the hungry. Whether it was the sea at Rameshwaram, Tumba and Chandipur, the desert at Pokhran, or the gigantic boulders in Hyderabad, nature has always made its presence felt wherever I have worked. It has helped to remind me of the divine force that pervades all of the creation. I kept on pondering over my dream, and yet the history of the world shows the forces of good struggling hard to make life better for mankind, while the human race also shows a terrible capacity for destruction. Thus we have Gandhi and other great saints and the teachers who lay down the precepts for a happy and virtuous life on the one hand, and on the other, the death of millions in the Second World War and the dropping of atomic bombs that destroyed entire cities. Thousands have died in the Bosnia conflict. The Israel-Palestine conflict continues to take lives. On the 11th September 2001, terrorists used a new tactic to take lives when they struck at the World Trade Center in New York. At home in the Bhopal gas tragedy, 30,000 people died as a result of a carelessness of a multinational company, and thousands more have died in the Kashmir Valley violence. On 13 December 2001, when the leaders of India were in parliament, an attempt was made by the terrorists to paralyze the country. Where will it all stop? Are we doomed to destroy ourselves? No, we have to find an everlasting solution. I recall a poem I wrote a few years ago, The Tree of Life. You, the human race, are the best of my creation. You will live and live and give till you are united in happiness and pain. My bliss will be born in you. Love is a continuum. That is the mission of humanity. You will see every day in the life tree. You learn and learn, and my best of creation. The five great human beings I saw in my dream lived at different times. In the modern world, there are a few examples of human beings who embodied the qualities that come from realizing the nature of the mind. Once a child asked me if I had read the Mahabharata, and if so, who my favorite characters in it was. The multifaceted characters in the epic represents almost every aspect of human nature, good as well as bad. I told the child that I was particularly attracted to the characteristics of Vidura, who showed grit against the wrongdoings of authorities and had the courage to defer when everyone else chose to surrender before the tyranny of Adharma. Today it is hard for us to find one true Vidura among our leaders. It is hard for us to imagine such an enlightened being, and even harder for us to aim for such enlightenment. More discouraging still is the quality of public life today, the low level of discourse, and the presence of so much ego, anger, greed, jealousy, spite, cruelty, lust, fear, anxiety, and turmoil. I felt a new determination dawning inside me. In this my most important decision, I decided to help discover the nature of India's true self in its children. My own work, and indeed I as a person, were relegated to the background. My scientific career, my team, my awards, all this became secondary. I wanted instead to be a part of the eternal intelligence that is India. I hoped to transcend myself and discover the inner higher self that is in us through my interaction with joyous children. A man is said to pass through different stages in his lifetime. Dr. Wayne W. Dyer, in his book Manifest Your Destiny, makes an interesting categorization of them as athlete stage, warrior stage, state person stage, and spirit stage. It occurred to me that nations too make a similar transition, and in extending this analogy to them, I have termed the last two stages Big Brother and self-realization stages, respectively. The stages do not follow in sequence necessarily. They can be coexistent with one aspect dominant. In the first, athlete stage, a nation fresh from an independent struggle or some other transition embarks on an energetic pursuit of performance and achievement. This has happened in Japan, Singapore, and Malaysia. When a nation leaves this stage behind, it generally enters the warrior stage, proud of its achievements. It finds ways to demonstrate its superiority over others, perhaps through conquest. Ego is the driving force. During this stage, people are busy with goals and achievements in competition with others, and this, as Dyer points out, for the individual generates anxiety. Convincing others of its superiority becomes the theme. In the next Big Brother stage, the ego has become tamed somewhat, and with its newfound maturity, awareness shifts to what is important to other nations and societies. In the Big Brother stage, the nation is still an achiever, but it is not so obsessed with proving its strength. The idea is to help others become better. The erstwhile Soviet Union, by its developmental role in some countries, had adopted this role. As with the individual, so too with the nations. The transition from the warrior stage to the Big Brother stage is a rewarding but difficult exercise. There is one stage even higher than this, Big Brother stage. In this, a nation recognizes its truest essence. It comes out of the wisdom that the earth is no single nation's inheritance but of all, and its people are aware of the responsibilities of the individuals towards his fellow human beings. This can be called the realization stage, and India may have the potential to achieve it. In my working career of 43 years, I have changed my tracks in several institutions. Change is crucial. It brings new thoughts. New thoughts leads to innovative actions. On 15th August 2001, I took a decision to go for another change. I mentioned my intention to Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee, who asked me to rethink. I had spoken to him of my desire to be relieved on a few earlier occasions too, but he advised me to continue and prevailed. As a rocket man too, I worked with stages. Each stage is jettisoned after taking the rocket further along its intended trajectory. I worked with Indian Space Research Organization during 63 to 82. In 1980, India launched its first satellite launch vehicle successfully that put the Rohini satellite into orbit and became a member of the exclusive space club. I headed a team as project director of the mission for SLV-3. Our success in this effort gave the nation satellite launch vehicle technology and enterprise expertise in control, guidance, propulsion, aerodynamics, besides the ability to design various rocket systems. Above all, this project enriched the organization with enhanced capabilities in design, development and management systems, integrating inputs from different institutions such as the R&D laboratories, industry and academic, and the program also gave leaders in technology and management. Today, they all are working in various space and defense programs. This was my first stage in which I learned leadership from three great teachers, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, Professor Satish Dhawan, and Dr. Brahma Prakash. This was a time of learning and acquisition of knowledge for me. The second stage could then be from in 82 in the Defense Research Development Organization, DRDO. Again, it was teamwork against the background of denial of technology through the instruments of the Missile Technology Control Regime and the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. I had the opportunity to work with teams and DRDO labs that led to the design, development, production and operationalization of two strategic missiles. These types of strategic missiles will not be available to India from any country, no matter how friendly our relations with it. During this period, three new laboratories and facilities, one in the area of missile technology called Research Center Imarat at Hyderabad, and two other missile test centers, one on the mainland and the other on an island near Chandipur on the coast of Bay of Bengal, were born with excellent capabilities. In addition, the nation became strong as capabilities in critical technologies emerged from laboratories and academic institutions that helped us overcome the constraints of MTCR. My team could design and develop my type of missile system, including the intercontinental ballistic missile. During this stage, I have gone through many successes and some failures. I learned from failures and hardened myself with courage to face them. This was my second stage, which taught me the crucial lesson of managing failures. The third stage can be the participation in India's mission to become a nuclear weapon stage, with a great partnership between the Department of Atomic Energy and DRDO with the support of armed forces. This was a mission well accomplished. However, when children ask me what has given you happiness in your life in the last 40 years, I say I get happiness when heart patients carry KR coronary stents in their arteries, and when the physically handicapped children fitted with a lightweight flow reaction orthosis calipers find their difficulties eased somewhat. Both of these came as spin-off from missile technologies. During this stage, I held the position of Chairman of the Technology Information Forecasting and Assessment Council under the Department of Science and Technology for nearly two tenures. about 8 years. This period saw the creation of Technology Vision 2020 based on the work of task teams consisting of 500 experts in all who had available to them inputs from 5,000 scientists and technologists from different fields. Later, the technology vision document and the national security aspects got integrated and the India Millennium Mission emerged. When I took over as principal scientific advisor to the Government of India in November 1999, the task was to do detailing and evolve a working plan for IMM 2020. It is indeed a roadmap for transforming India into a developed country. The second vision of the nation, certain experimental work on education, agriculture, and also development of the number of villages in an integrated way is currently progressing. A cabinet paper on the subject has been moved for approval of the subject has been moved for approval of the government. During this third stage, it was building technology strength with institutional partnership, adapting technology to societal needs and formulating the vision for the nation that occupied me. The helicopter mishap of 30th September 2001 made me realize that the time to jettison the third stage had arrived. This thought was further reinforced on 2nd October, the birthday of Mahatma Gandhi, when I visited Mata Amritanandamayi Ashram at Kollam in Kerala. She emphasized the need to integrate spirituality with education to create a new generation of leaders and entrepreneurs. On 12th October 2001, 3 days before I could complete my 70 orbits around the sun, I formally wrote to the Prime Minister about my decision to retire and requested to be relieved in a month's time. He relented this time and I prevailed. Meanwhile, I keep visiting schools. During my visit to many states, particularly two of the northeastern states, Assam and Tripura and Jharkhand, and also a few places in Tamil Nadu, I have addressed thousands of students, about 40,000 at last count. I have found that I communicate well with this age group. I share their imagination. Most important, though my interaction with them, I feel I can ignite in their minds a love for science and through it a sense of mission for achieving a developed India. Will this be my fourth stage? Shall I be successful? I really don't know. But what I do know is that there is no greater power in heaven or on earth than the commitment to a dream. Dreams often hold something of that energy which lies at the heart of all things and are the binding force that brings the spiritual and the material together. It has been in my mind for the past few years to undertake research and teaching, and for this purpose, combined with the desire to find time to meet school children, I have shifted to Anna University, my alma mater. What a great feeling it is to be known young, to be among young people bubbling with creativity and enthusiasm. What a great responsibility the elders of this country have at hand to guide this tremendous energy in a constructive way for nation building. How can we make up for missed opportunities and the failures of the past? Spirituality must be integrated with education. Self-realization is the focus. Each one of us must become aware of our higher self. We are links of a great power for a grand future. We should ignite our dormant inner energy and let it guide our lives. The radiance of such minds embarked on constructive endeavors will bring peace, prosperity and bliss to this nation. So we saw the preface and the chapter 1.